Just in preparation, I'm going to hand out some index cards. Would you mind taking one and pass it along? Just take one and pass it along. And if you could all make yourself acquainted with a pen, be ready to write something down. I have two Sharpies. So if anyone needs a pen, I need one. You can have the other. You're all okay? So you guys at the door, decide. Come in, go away. Who's saying hello? Yes. Have you guys had a good day? What's the best thing that you've heard today? Mob programming. Sean, the speaker that was in here just then, told a really, really good story about agile coaching. Are any of you guys agile coaches? Did you sit through his talk? Oh, my goodness. And I was listening to him, and I thought it was a really good presentation. He told the story really well, and it was good information. And about halfway through, I went, oh, crap, the mob programming thing is next door. And I was towards the front, and I was like, anyway. Thank you very much for coming in today. I did an activity or two last year at Agile India. Did any of you guys come along to that? None of you. Well, lucky you did. Yeah. So as you know, I don't like to work very hard. I'm management. I work at a company called Aconex. And we've got a team here in Bangalore, and I just happened to be here this week, so it was convenient that the conference was on. What I was doing on Thursday and Friday is I was running a conference, an Agile conference in Melbourne in Australia, and so I flew from one to the other, and that's kind of funny. It's even less work than management. So I put this together intending to do this session at the conference in Melbourne and to have practiced it for you guys, but I didn't, because I was at the conference. And have you guys heard of Alistair Coburn? Right, Agile Manifesto guy, one of the dozen men that started the Agile Manifesto. So he came to the conference as a keynote. And on Friday afternoon, I was running a workshop activity, and a little bit beforehand, he comes up to me, he's, Craig, I've got this great idea for a game. Be my guest. And so he took over the session that we ran. So I haven't actually rehearsed this. What could possibly go wrong? Yeah, exactly. Anyway, here we are. We're ready to start. I think we're settled down. So the theme is improved together. And the reason it's improved together is 2 or 3 years ago, Coburn, as one of the grandfathers of Agile, and I were having a conversation in Melbourne. And he was talking to me about, it's so complicated these days. There's all these methods, there's all these frameworks, there's all these elaborations, and it's getting harder and harder to buy into it. At the end of the day, he came up with this meme called The Heart of Agile. Some of you might have come across it on the internet. And if you haven't, it's worth having a look at The Heart of Agile. What he's saying in that is, like, let's put some principles back into the conversation and get away from frameworks and methods, because frameworks and methods can sometimes be a red herring. What we really need to do is have guiding principles. When we're applying the frameworks and methods, we can check them against the principles and see if we're heading in the right direction, right? So, hello. So the Heart of Agile idea comes up with these kind of four principles, and it's almost like a plan, do, check, act cycle. And the Heart of Agile is starting anywhere you like in the cycle, deliver, reflect, improve, and collaborate. Alternatively, it could be improve, collaborate, deliver, and reflect. You start anywhere and you just cycle through that and you keep on going, where are we at right now? And you can ask yourself questions. Do we need to collaborate more? You know what collaboration feels like and looks like, and maybe you could do it better. Do we need to deliver better? Maybe we do, right? Do we need to improve better? Anyway, all of that. The topic that I chose to anchor my talk on is this idea of improving. And so, this is what I'm talking about with you guys. It's linked to that heart of agile meme. And then I thought about where I work and what we do. We build software for the construction industry, okay? Fair enough. Most of us are involved in building software. What we do is we build a collaboration platform. That's what we call it. And so this notion of collaborating together is in the DNA of our company. And I look around and I go, yeah, the industry's got its ways of working, and then Aconex is a kind of a peculiar beast. It's got a very weird personality when you work inside it. And it purposefully doesn't follow industry patterns and standards, and it purposefully tries to do things different, sometimes in a good way, often in a really frustrating and stupid way. But that's okay, because in general, the company gets a little bit better year after year, and everything's kind of heading in the right direction. But it's interesting because there's a map of our teams, and the reason I'm in Bangalore, like I come from Melbourne, that's our head office, and that's where it started. And then 6 or 7 years ago, we opened our second development center here in Bangalore, and it's grown slowly, and now it's kind of big enough that we've had to change offices a couple of times. But we're in the business of collaborating, and we're in the business of helping customers work together, just like you guys are in the agile community, right? It's like, what do you see? You see, if we put people together and get them on the same page and unify their goals and get them to talk to each other and get them to get the power relationships out of the way and all that sort of stuff, things just work better. And so we kind of put that into software, and other people do the same sort of thing. And, you know, and as a result, our company does things like, you know, we've got these nice little statements about, you know, we make the world a better place, and everyone wants to have that as a part of their story, right? But linking that back to improving together, that's the little preamble, right? Linking, why would I come along and want to talk about this? That's, I guess, I'm just trying to explain myself. Well, what does improving together? You might have read the introduction that I had, right? So it was full of assertions, right? And I'm going to leave it to you to research those assertions and find out how true they are. But it's the question is, how does your team improve? And what are the limits to what you can do? So I've got this notion that best practices, right, are a dead end, a red herring. And when we look at things like Scrum or XP or Kanban and we think that's a pattern, we should follow it, we're making a terrible mistake. It's not that Scrum, XP and Kanban in themselves are bad. It's just if we lift it up and we drop it on our teams, we've done something wrong. And I guess this links up to what Sean was saying in the talk before. There's annoyance to this, like looking at the work and figuring out how to improve things, which is about the context and the situation and the people, and we need to attend to those people. So don't seek a standard, but do seek to do better and continue to do better. Like Aconex as a company started around 2000 or so, and it kind of drank the agile Kool-Aid in about 2007. And so we've been doing this agile stuff for 10 years, and it came from when the company was small. So it wasn't like an enterprise, you're trying to disrupt it and break it. It's just like at a certain point, we needed to put some practices and disciplines to kind of pull the team together and get them oriented the right way. But then the team kind of grew through that and matured through that, and they left Scrum. And you know, there are aspects of XP and there are aspects of Scrum all over the place, but no one's got a Scrum Master. We don't have any standard processes and practices around software development. We do around some things. You've got to kind of coordinate communication and taking things to market and all that sort of stuff. But at the end of the day, what we're doing is we're kind of stumbling into the problem and then going, what are we going to do about this? And one of the problems we've got at the moment is linking up all the teams, right? We got at the moment 20-something teams, 28 teams or so, and they're all pumping stuff out every couple of weeks, maybe every month. And what does that do? The sales force, you know, the customer service people, how do they absorb all that information, right? It's really hard. We don't know the answer yet, but it's our new problem. So we're going to go figure it out. And we'll look around and we'll look for patterns, but then what we'll do is we'll go, what do we need to do for our circumstance? Yeah? So that's the thinking that's behind this thing, this workshop that we're going to do together. Workshop, I hear you say. Well, That's because I'm almost finished talking. Very soon, you're going to do all the work. So, the theme, improve together. Why did I put those two words together? The first part is improve, and the second part is together. So I've got this kind of three-step activity that I want to go through with you. And it involves believing this, right? It involves that better, the assertion that better is better than best, right? So continually evolving to improve is better than attacking a best practice. And I kind of get this, my connection to the Agile manifesto is this bit, right? The rest of it, you know, we've all looked at that thing over and over again. I'm sick of looking at it. But I'm never sick of looking at this bit, like figuring out new stuff with each other and sharing our information. That's the cool bit. The rest of it's just stuff. Continually learning and continually improving is the best bit. So, improving. So here we are in the activity bit. You've got your cards. Has anyone not got an index card? Excellent. Here you go. Could you just pass that way? Where's it? Hands up. Yep, come and get them. There's a collection. Here you go. Just pass him back that way. So, it's good practice when doing these sort of things to... I've got more up here if anyone needs them. It's good practice when doing these things to explain the learning outcome you seek, explain all the steps, then go back to the step in front of us and explain that. If I were to do that, I would be a good facilitator instead of a manager. Instead, I'm going to give half-assed explanations and hope you do your best. Well, I'll do a little bit. I'll try to explain it a little bit. So, what's the activity, right? So what I want you to do on the card right now is, with your pen, too kind of big, but just pick a thing, right? One thing, right on the card. Just watching the room, people are thinking, scratching their heads, wondering. When you've done that, what I'd like you to do, I've already bored somebody. Just kidding. What I'd like you to do now is write why that is a useful practice, right? What problem does it solve for you? Question? Okay, so you've written an agile best practice on the card. Now underneath that, I want you to write why it is good for you. What problem does it solve for you? Sorry? One. Well, you can have two or three reasons, but only one practice. And when you're done, just give me some sort of wave of the card or something so I can get a vibe of how much of the room is completed. All right, just give it a second longer. While we're waiting for the other guys to finish writing their notes, you can sit there and be very mindful. Think deeply about why that's such a good practice. Okay. Now, what was that word that we were looking at a minute ago? Improve. Better. That was it. Flip the card over. And thinking about the or one of the problems that you were addressing with that best practice, think of something better. Think of something better than that best practice. And actually, it's going to be difficult. So what I'd like you to do is pair up with someone near you. If you're sitting by yourself, maybe you just get up and move around. So take a minute, take 2 minutes, hell, take three, but better, right? So if you went, let's think of something. If you go retrospectives, did anyone say retrospectives? Right, so I'm not going to use that. Did anyone go daily stand-ups? Right, that's a few. Did anyone do test-driven development? You're a software developer. Sorry? Coding. Sorry? Just coding. Right. Well, I'll pick something obscure, right? Like I'll say domain-driven design. Right? No one's used that, have they? Right, so we go, well, why do we use domain-driven design? And the reason we use that approach is so that we can navigate through the app later, right? Right now, for the next few weeks or even months, we all know what we're working on and we get it, right? But in 4 years' time, when someone comes to work on this again, they're going to have no clue. So let's label things properly when we're writing up our solution. Yeah? That's the problem. So what's better than domain-driven design? Is there a better thing that you could do? Right? I don't have an answer right now in my head. But is there a better thing? So that's what I'd like you to do now. Flip the card over, write something that's better than retrospectives. Right? That solves the problem you're trying to solve. Yes? Can't hear me? All right. Did you get the instruction? I will repeat it. I'll come and stand here. So the idea is, you've written a good practice. You've written why it's a good practice. Flip the card over. Write something that's better than that good practice that addresses the problem space. How are we going? And when you're done, just give me one of those little waves. It's not that easy, is it? Yeah. But talk to the people around you if you need help. Brainstorm together. When I was in that conference on Thursday. Sorry? When I was at that conference on Thursday, what was I going to say? on Friday. It was actually on Thursday. It was a 2-day conference. When I was on the conference on Thursday, if you'd like to pair up to solve this activity. I'm not now. I was just giving that as a technique to work through this activity. Have you got your answer? What have you got? Yeah, and better. Daily. Oh, yeah, right. And I'll use you as an example. All right. How are we going? Done? Give me a little wave. Okay, it's harder than it looks, right? Keep going, keep going. Yes. Can be, but you want to look for better. So take a good example is take Scrum's. Let's deliver quarterly or monthly or every 2 weeks, right? An improvement on that was Kanban that just said continuous flow, right? So and it kind of solves the problem of like reducing the big batch problem, right? So there's an example. What other examples do you have? A lot of you guys said retrospectives and stand-ups. What problem are you trying to solve? Could you do something better? So, you know, there's the 15-minute stand-up. Why do we do 15-minute stand-ups? What about 10 minutes? Does that solve the problem? What about no stand-ups? Does that solve the problem? Right? So what could you do that's going to get you to better? Now, the trick is, you have to do this bit because I need the answer to this for the next activity. Doing stuff like this certainly does give you an appreciation for those people that come up with frameworks. Are any of you guys agile trainers? That like any trainers that do Scrum training or anything like that? One of the activities in the training milieu is to get people to design their own frameworks, right? So you teach them a whole bunch of stuff and then you go, right, now class, design your own framework. And then people do their stuff and more or less it looks like Scrum. So, yeah, that's a thing. We good? How are we going? Anyone need more time? Because we're not in a rush. It's the end of the day. I'm just chatting away with you. All right. So click, click, click. All right, so you've got your thing. Now, what I want you to do is just take a moment to share that with the person next to you. What was your better? Right? Now it's the conversation time. So turn to your partner and say, and I'm going to use you as an example. Sorry, Tarek. Tarek here. Wait. Follow the instructions. Don't start yet. Hold it on your lip. So, Tarek came up with retrospectives, and the problem that they address is,
The good thing about retrospective is addressing the performance proactively and visiting the doctor before being dead.
So there you go. So retrospectives, proactively get in front of problems, visit the doctor before you're dead, right? Can I have a look? And his version of better is rather than do, say, fortnightly retrospectives, is to do a daily retrospective. So you could, at the end of each day, do a health check. How are we going as a team? Is there anything we need to do better? Right? Lovely idea. Yeah. And maybe that's going to take 5 minutes instead of an hour and a half. Right? Great improvement. So you're all talking to each other now? Because they are. Don't be left out. Get into the conversation. All right. Okay. Has everyone had their turn? Now you're warmed up. Now you're warmed up, I can't shut you up. Okie dokie. In 30 seconds, I want you to stop. Okay, thank you everyone. Wrap it up. Wrap it up. I got this microphone going on. Hello. Is this better, guys? You really do have to have it sitting on your lip. If I do this, look at that. That's a finger width away and you can't hear me. Anyway, so can I just have some of our esteemed audience members share an improvement? Yes, my friend, hang on. Don't forget, put this on your lip.
Initially, I wrote retrospection, but then when it is better, I wrote it as daily retrospection helps to improve on a daily basis.
Could I have an... Yes, you look ready.
So I wrote sprint planning as the best practice. The reason people come together in a meeting, they estimate it together, commit for it, and... it's more likely to succeed. Sprint planning was the best practice. The improvement, in real world, normally there is a sprint plan set out there. The plan changes over the course because there's some other urgent tasks or which normally hamper the plan. So the improvement is to discuss it on a daily basis. Are we there? Are we following it? And is there a need to recalibrate and ensure that we are all adjusted?
That is an outstanding activity to do, isn't it? Like, let's replan every single day, make sure we're on track for doing the right thing.
Yep. The thing that I've mentioned is... on the lip. Thing that I've mentioned is more or less related to continuous delivery, although we have not been able to achieve all of it, but up to some extent, we have achieved it. The improvement which is there is that even if the things are available, associated stakeholders are not probably spending enough time or at right moment to give those valuable feedbacks. So improvement would be to increase the frequency or increase the efforts by stakeholders to use things which are available and give their inputs.
Cool. So pull the stakeholders into the project more intimately. Great improvement. One more. Does anyone... What about the back row? No, sorry, I'm going to go to the very back row. You guys got one? Yeah? The very back corner of the back row.
Now, I talked about the retrospective, but I didn't share anybody because like I was in the middle and they two shared. So I couldn't get a better practice. I was just wondering what to write and what not. So
Well, at least he's brave enough to stand up and say, I didn't do my homework. Okay, cool. So did you see that? Did you see that there's great ideas? All you got to do is stop and think about them, and they're not necessarily in a manual, right? So great potential in all of you to find better ways of working. So that's the improve bit. That's just a great example. Well, that's a simple example, I should say. You're going to say something to me. I'm going to bring it over. That's a simple example of just a technique to keep pushing the boundaries. What are you going to be doing in 10 years' time after all this basic agile stuff is way behind you? Yes, Tamay.
I was just going to ask you that, you know, why we did this exercise, we said that these are better ways of doing stuff. And, you know, there has been foundation laid and people practicing it for so many years. And then they've come to this conclusion, these are the best practices. Now, not knowing how this will turn out, so maybe daily retrospectives might not turn out the way we are expecting it to be. So, you know, in our minds, it is a better way of doing it, but it may not be the better way of doing it.
Right. So the question, the bottom line in that question is like, how do I know to trust the patterns and practices in front of me? Right. And the answer is trust, but check. Right. Maybe it's a good idea, but look at your circumstances. Try everything as a hypothesis, as an experiment. Right. Let's try this fortnightly retrospective thing and see what happens. Right. It doesn't work. Don't necessarily throw it out straight away. Maybe look at the way you run it and improve it. Right. So when retrospectives are widely adopted across the industry and people are talking about how good they are, maybe there's something to master. But maybe not. I don't think all our teams run retrospectives. I think the majority of them do not. Right? And actually, out of the ones that do, back in Melbourne, most of the retrospectives involve whiskey and beer. And it's more like the end of the week, they get together and say, did any of you guys ever see a show? It had, I can't remember both of the actors, one of them was William Shatner, and it was called Boston Legal. Did any of you see that TV show? Some of you did. At the end of each episode, there were these two lawyers, and the other one was, what was the other actor? James Spader. James Spader and William Shatner. And it's a big fancy law firm in Boston. And at the end of each episode, they'd be standing on the balcony with big fat cigars and whiskeys, and they go, well, wasn't that an exciting adventure? Right, so that's the vibe that some of these retrospectives are like. It's like, how about that week? Let's not do that again. Or, well, that was good, wasn't it? Aren't we proud of the things that we did? But they're quite casual. So that's the first part, right? Don't think that these best practices are an end state. They're just a stepping stone. They're taking you somewhere else, right? But the somewhere else is something that you're going to design with the people you work with. The next part of this activity. How are we going so far? Right, you okay? Happy so far? Cool. I'm really tired. I flew over from Australia on Sunday into the evening, and then I got to the hotel at 4 a.m., and then I slept for 2 hours, then I went to work. And then last night, I went to sleep at 10:30. Right, and when you're in the wrong time zone, never go to sleep at 10:30. Stay up as late as you can, because I woke up at 12:30 and didn't go back to sleep. I tell you that because it builds some amicability and some rapport, right? Which points us at this next activity. When we bring change to the teams and the organizations that we work with, what vector do we approach the change from? Are any of you guys agile coaches, scrum masters, managers? Just give me a little one of them, right? So, change managers, no change managers willing to admit that. Oh, you two, brave. just joking. So the idea is, do we assert change on people or do we change things together, right? And so you don't improve people and teams. People and teams improve themselves. And I suppose that's a theme that you've heard throughout the day. Yes? No. I'm the first person that's hinted at this. Everyone's been saying it all day long, right? And so Thucydides, I was just looking for an interesting picture at this point. I went, what's it? Like my slides are pretty shit so far, so I thought I'd get a good picture, and I got this one. But, you know, this idea of like the strong will be strong and the weak will be weak, and there's a power imbalance there and it's going to play itself out, right? So we, as mindful practitioners of this agile stuff or this management stuff or this software development stuff, whatever it is we do, we should be aware of the power dynamics, and especially if you're in a role of authority, and you should try to not assert your authority onto other people, but partner with people, right? So when Sean, the guy that was talking in this room before me, was talking, he was talking as an agile coach. When I was successful, what I would do is I would walk around and I would share knowledge, and then the teams that were keen on that would pick it up and use it, and then they would be effective and successful. But when I tried to tell people how to do their job, oh my goodness. Right? Have you ever been in that circumstance? Yeah, right. So you know, let's partner together. So to demonstrate that, I'm going to do an activity with you. Once again, I need you to partner up with someone. And my friend in the back corner, you're a good man. Yes. No, you can stay there. Actually, let's all give him a round of applause for being a good man. What I want you to do is pair up. It's got to be pairs. And if there's odd numbers, there can be one odd number, right? Everyone should be in pairs. There can be one group of three, right? Can you all just organize yourselves really quickly into that? Okay. So with these index cards, what I would like you to do, the tallest of the two of you, you might have to stand up. Come on. On your feet. On your feet. Stand up. Right. Look at your partner. Which is the taller? Right. You've recognized who the tallest of the pair is? Great. You can now sit down again. Okay. So I'm all about collaboration, and I'm all about doing it with you, not to you. So just shut up for a minute. What I would like you to do, tall people, is tell your shorter companion how good your idea is, explain to them how to execute on it, and convince them that it's something that they should take to work next week. Right? You've got good ideas, right? Are they good ideas? Did anyone come up with a rubbish idea? Right, so there's lots of good ideas in the room. So now you're going to pitch your good idea at the other person and convince them that it's a really good thing to do. Can you please take 3 minutes to do that? At the end of 3 minutes, I'm going to call time. No, the idea that you wrote on the card. Yeah. Anyone need any help? Okie dokie. Time. Have you managed to tell your story yet? Have you explained it? Yeah? You got the basic ideas across? Some people still going? I'll stop them in a minute. Okay, can you please stop talking? Yeah? Hello? Hello? Hello, microphone. Oh, the Wi-Fi's got a rant. Hello? Hello? Is this working? You can hear it. I can't hear it. Right. Okay, so, short people, stand up. No, if. Stand up if you are convinced compellingly that you need to take this good idea back to work next week. Okay, so.
Sorry?
Okay, so what I want you to do now is... once again, Once again, I want the tall people to start the conversation. Sorry, short people. It's not that you don't count. You're going to do most of the talking. But this time I want the tall people in the pair to ask the other person about their good idea, to explore it, to have a conversation about how it could be used and how it could be useful. All right? Just go through that conversation. Same sort of thing. We'll call it 3 minutes and it'll turn into five. So, go. You got it? Okay. So, I'll say it again. Right? What I want you to do is this time the tall person is going to turn to the short person with them and say, hey, about the thing you wrote on the card, can you tell me what it was? And can you tell me how it's useful? And can you tell me how it's better than a standard agile practice? Yeah? And I want you to inquire, to discover what that good idea is and to discover how it might be useful for you. Yeah? So go ahead. Do the interview. Do the asking. Okie dokie. Last 30 seconds. Yeah. I'm just going to start shutting you down. It's time. You ready? Hello? Hello? Thank you very much. Hello, thank you.
Hello.
So, the first time somebody pitched their idea, the second time somebody inquired, how did it feel? What was the difference? Does anyone, not the idea, but the experience. Let's just take a moment and think about the experience you went through thinking and listening and asking questions versus telling, right? And can I have a couple of people just, yes, I'm going to ask for some people to reflect out loud for the room.
So basically, I was asking him as to there's a. Yeah, now. So basically, I was asking for there are problems in the design, and there are some leakages that are happening, and people are finding it later in the QA and development time. So what is the way we can handle these things? And by himself, he identified as to, you know, what are the possible solutions and ways to catch hold of them. And they themselves came out with the solution that the design reviews could capture these problems, correct? So vis-a-vis the previous one where this was imposed in saying that, you know, the team should do the design review or team should do the code review, and the acceptance was not there.
So how did it feel?
I, as a recipient or the, you know, person who was inquiring, it was more of that, you know, I was not imposing, so I was free. I was learning from the ecosystem as to, you know, what people will have in their mind and what they will accept.
Can I have another volunteer?
So basically, I had this daily stand-up. And my initial partner had suggested three ways to improve it. And it was one with sending minutes after the daily stand-up. Another was daily stand-up with optional retro. And third was doing twice a week if there are longer stories. So when he was trying to explain me, okay, this is the solution or can be the better way, I was not very convinced initially. Then I went through all of them and analyzed, okay, I liked the second one, like daily stand-up with optional retro, very nice. And when I was pitching to my second partner, I was more confident, like, this is something, yes, this will help to make it better. So that was more.
So in the first scenario, your partner pitched an idea to you. In the second one, your new partner asked questions. Now, how did it feel being in that different type of dialogue?
Well, it feels more confidence when I'm telling something to other people. And I feel like more empowered, like that I feel that, yes, I can explain something to people like that.
Not based on this particular experience, but you know, typically you face this always in your work life, right? If somebody tells you to do something, there is always that initial reluctance, right? Okay, this guy is telling me, does he know better than me, right? Whereas, he's teaching me, you know? But if you willingly go out to the other person, you ask for a suggestion, and that person gives it to you, it's your need, which he's advising you. So I think the receptivity of it at a personal level is so much more.
Yeah, like, I mean, you know, this is obviously the point that I'm trying to make. Does anyone else want to share one last example? You.
So, one thing I noticed was, in the first case, I was already thinking in my mind that I have to frame my statement, like, it has to be bulletproof. I will say this, 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 and hence that person has to accept. Whereas in this, I was like, just, I was speaking like I was thinking, like I was fumbling, and like, as I was thinking it, I was saying it, and there was no cognitive load, like I was comfortable, like, because there was no judgment, probably.
Sorry, I finished that.
Yeah, so.
Okay. I reached a second too long. But I love that statement, like, I felt more free to speak because I wasn't being judged, because we were having a conversation, not because somebody's telling something, the what, where, and how. So I love that. That was essentially the two parts, the yin and the yang, to improve together, right? So one part is, like, how can we think about more, better than best, right? Like, what are the pathways to finding a better way to do things? And the second way is, not telling people how to improve, but finding improvements together and having conversations and doing it in partnership with each other. So they're the two things. And so I made it an activity, because I really feel like you can sit here and listen to people talk, talk, talk. It's the end of the day. You're sick of that, right? You want to do something. You want to have a conversation with each other. And then you can build some little muscle memory around this. You can try something. And now you've had this type of conversation. Maybe you're all used to it. Maybe some of you aren't. And you can go back to your teams and you can do similar types of conversations. So that's what I wanted to get out of it. And the last point before I wrap it up, because in 30 seconds I'm going to get thrown out of the room. It's the last two sentences. This happened last year too. That's one sentence. Oh, damn it, that's the archer coming on in. Might see you next year. Bye-bye.